Let me start with a small story which happened to me when I was working in Moscow, in Russia. So I'm talking to this childhood friend of mine on the phone, and I'm talking in Hindi. This friend of mine is in the US, and I'm saying, "Tumhari baat hui." He's saying, "Tumhari baat hui," which is basically means, "Did you talk to him?" And I said, "Hui." "Yes, I did talk to him." "Baat hui?" "Hui." And suddenly, the energy in the room changes. I can see people stopping midway in the conversation and giving me the looks. It's a look which is a mixture of amazement and shock. Some people have stopped their work and looking at me. What I didn't know at that point and realized later on is hui is actually the Russian slang for the male organ. So it did cement my reputation in that whole, in the office as Mr. Hui. So everybody will talk about and will say, "Oh yeah, you know, that's Mr. Hui." And it also gave me an entry into any conversation where I could go and introduce myself as, "Yeah, hi, I'm Mr. Hui." And consider my amazement when I moved to Netherlands after Russia, where I realized that hoi is actually the word for hi. So there everybody goes, "Hoi," which any Russian would go like, "My God, what's going on?" So diversity per se is a reality today. You see diversity in every aspect of life. You see it in education, you see it in work, you see it in politics, you see it in society. We are all getting impacted by it. But while diversity is a reality, are we inclusive? And let me just focus on one aspect. The space where we spend over 50% of our waking life, which is our workplace. How good are we at cultural or any kind of inclusion at workplace? See, the output culture of an organization will always be influenced by the individuals who are there. If I were to consider all of you as little small pieces of a tile or a tesser, like blue, red, green, yellow, orange, purple, maroon, and if all of you were to be put in these tiles, what is the end output? Is the end output a huge mosaic where you have all these tiles? Or is the end output a melting pot where all the colors melt and you get a common shade? What I'm saying is, in an organization, is the culture, the one you achieve, one that keeps every individual, keep their unique parts? Or is the culture one that accepts that there is a set of behavior, there is a set of principles that everybody has to adhere to? And we are not just talking race, we are talking race, gender, sexual orientation, disability. Every aspect that makes us unique. Now, inclusion in itself is a two-way street. We, as a tile, are trying to fit into the bigger picture, but the bigger picture is also coping with so many tiles coming in and trying to figure out how exactly am I evolving as a bigger picture. So let me first focus on the individual aspect. And the individual aspect is something what I tried calling is like, when you join a team or an organization, it's like the elephant and the mouse in the room, where you are not the elephant, the mouse. So as the mouse, what do you need to know about the elephant? Everything. You need to know how the elephant moves. When he wakes up, how does he walk? Where does he sit? What does he eat? Your very existence is dependent on how the elephant in the room behaves. That is exactly the reason why many of your friends who are not from London know more about London than you do. Because they would have learned a lot more than what their British friends know. I'll narrate one more instance from Moscow. So I'm at this metro station called the Mayakovskaya metro station, beautiful metro station with a Dutch friend and this very amazing looking Russian colleague of ours. Both of us are trying to impress her. So we go ballistic about facts about Mayakovskaya metro station. Who built the pillars? What do these tiles mean? What do these circles mean? Who was speaking here? And you can imagine how she was feeling. She felt embarrassed. She felt scared of these two nerds. And we were kept guessing why we are not getting invited to the office drinks afterwards. So what people do is they try really hard to fit in. They try and understand the nuances. They try to get the jokes. They try to get the references. People who are not native English speakers have this moment when the penny drops, when they start understanding what British mean when they say, "Interesting." And more often than not, this acceptance doesn't happen. When this doesn't happen, which is very quickly replaced by a feeling, which is shame. And you know what Brené Brown, one of the leading thinkers of this day, defines as shame as? Shame is fear of disconnection. I'm not good enough. I'm not smart enough. I'm not acceptable enough. And so what do? You go cold. You start numbing yourself. You convince yourself that you really love to have that ham and cheese sandwich in front of your computer watching that expense sheet. You convince yourself you do not want to go after this meet to a drink and go home and watch Friends again. We have been talking about trains today. Let me tell you how people behave in a tube. Have you seen how people behave in a London tube? Everybody finds a unique spot to focus on. Sometimes it is somebody else's shoes. There are only two problems you can have in a London tube. First, if two people are looking at the same spot. Others think they're missing out something, they also start focusing on the same spot. Second, if two eyes meet. Now you really don't know what to do. Should I look away? Should I smile? Will it be rude? Oh my God, 3 seconds, now what to do? Offices are no different. In offices, the only saving grace is there is mobile connection. So what do? You look at the screen. Tell me, how does social media get 2 billion users to spend 135 minutes per day? Now let me talk about the elephant. The elephant is not oblivious that there is a mouse there. So what the elephant does, the elephant tries to share its food. It sets aside a few leaves for the mouse, sometimes red leaves, because you know it's a Chinese New Year, so red leaves for the Chinese New Year. But the elephant thinks like an elephant. The elephant thinks in trying to understand what the mouse might want. We in organizations take pride in publishing something like diversity reports. We set aside days to celebrate different festivals and events. I'll tell you, once I flew from Germany, an airport in Germany, to India on Diwali day, and the whole airport was celebrating Diwali. There was a steakhouse which was decorated to celebrate Diwali. Hindus don't eat beef. So even with the best of our intentions, sometimes we get it wrong. Organizations for a very long time have equated themselves with marching armies. At one point of time, The Art of War was the most famous business manual. Predominantly, we would come and say, we want to create a similar set of beliefs, we want a similar set of practices, and organizations will go on like that. But then globalization happened. And suddenly we were working with people from different cultures, we were working with people from different countries. There was a whole different paradigm. On top of it, societies changed. Now people in societies do not want to identify themselves as part of a group, but what makes them unique or what makes them different. So it wasn't just about the food that was being served in the canteen, whether that was culturally different, but it was about work ethics. It was about boss-subordinate relationship. It was about working hours. So how do we get it right? We have now created, like, we want to create a mosaic, but we have created a mechanism that creates a melting pot. And I am an analyst by profession, so I cannot leave this floor until I give recommendations. So I have three recommendations to give. The first thing which makes organization, and let me start with the individual, is, as Brené Brown puts it, whatever makes you vulnerable makes you beautiful. People who make meaningful connections in life are those who believe that they are worthy of a connection. So don't hold back on any opportunity that is there to connect. Connect with authenticity, connect with honesty, connect with what is unique to you. You want to apply for a job which is there in your office intranet that has been posted, which fits your resume? Go ahead and do it. Don't let the thoughts come that, you know, my English is not good enough, or I have not worked in this market, I'm very new to this company. Be realistic, be honest, but this experience will teach you more than what you had bargained for. And what will happen is you will not just learn. At one point of time, even if it didn't work out, even if you didn't get that job, even if it failed, don't numb yourself. See, the problem with numbing is, and I was listening to Dr. Amy and we were talking about that mask. When you numb pain, when you numb fear, you also numb joy. You also numb happiness. You cannot numb selectively. And that is the thing. So you have to be that you go out and you think, I am enough. I'm good as I am, I'm unique, and I'll go out there. For organizations, my recommendation or my advice is think like Jeff Bezos thinks. Jeff Bezos says, good intentions don't work. Only mechanisms do. Don't try and fix things with good intentions. Instead, make mechanisms which will fix the problem, which will make your organizations more inclusive. I'll give you an example. For years, we have been trying to make our workplace diversity friendly. In a sense, disability friendly. People with disability should be taken more in the workplace. We have changed policy. We have changed our advertisements. We have changed even government laws in some countries. It hasn't worked. Why? Even today, managers, we have done, I go out and read in different places, managers have to go and get 50 exceptions, or as they call us, reasonable adjustments, before they can take anybody with a disability in their workforce. This is basically their approval from HR, from finance, from facilities, from legal, sometimes from their line managers, sometimes from their seniors, sometimes even from the board. Why? If you make a workplace which is disability friendly for everybody, you remove the question of intention. People can automatically come in and then start working. Now, some will say, oh, that's expensive. No, it's not. I'll tell you what. To use a mouse which is operated by your retina and not by your hands is $40. 8% of the world male population actually suffers from color blindness. They've never told you that. Most people haven't told. The software is now free with all new operating systems, which actually makes sense for all those pie charts that you have been showing and people have not been understanding. And guess what? If you do that, there is no question of an intention. And my final thing is for both organizations and individuals is to act with courage to experiment and to improve. It's not an easy path. It will take a while to work, but it will work. Stop pretending that we are perfect and we make no mistakes. We are vulnerable as individuals and as organizations. We need to respect that and we need to work with that. Imagine that you have traveled, let's say, to Germany, and in Germany you are invited to an office get together. You're standing at the corner, looking at your phone, playing Candy Crush, and you're now guessing, should I join that gang of people? I know they're from my department and they're talking there. Think about the people who are standing there. They are looking at you and they are thinking, should we invite this British colleague? Do we change our language from German to English? Should we actually get the person involved? My thing is that, are you ready to add one more tile into your mosaic? Are you ready to get that person into the conversation? Or as you can do what I do. Hi, I'm Mr. Hui. You want to hear about Mayakovsky metro station? Thank you.